Welcome to Look Up with Pastor Mike and his wife Linda Sasso of Calvary Chapel of Eagle, a radio ministry designed to assist you in applying God's Word to your everyday life. For the next hour, Pastor Mike and Linda will encourage you with your walk with Christ and help you look up to Jesus. If you need advice on marriage, life challenges, or relationships, call in now. It's time to look up to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Here's Mike and Linda.
Well, hi, everybody. This is Pastor Mike, and I am live in studio with my wife, Linda. We're looking forward to continuing this series. Now, I must admit, I'm borrowing this article from the Fire Study Bible, and then we're adding our comments to it. There was an article I discovered called Nine Ways to Have Assurance of Salvation. And it's funny, I was just looking through articles that might be good to discuss on the air, and the next day, or was it maybe I was looking in the morning, and then that afternoon on the show, somebody asked, how do you know if you're saved? How can you tell, I lack assurance of salvation? Somewhere along those lines, I had just looked at this, I thought, well, this would be a great article to go through. Now, I'll warn you, and then I'm going to have Linda give you information on how you could communicate with us. But I'll just warn you, these are not ways to get saved. They're ways to test yourself. They're ways to examine your life. They're ways, as a matter of fact, that article is called Nine Ways to Have Assurance of Salvation. And I'm looking at it more like why Christians don't have assurance, and it's nine reasons why. That's kind of how I look at it, okay? So we will get into this in a moment, but first I'm going to have Linda tell you how you could, connect with us. I really want to hear from you guys today. It'd be great to have a caller. Sometimes we go host show and don't get a caller, and we always get text and comments. People like to use social media and texting, but listen, somebody call in.
Hi, everybody. We would love for you to call. The number is 208-377-3790. Okay, this is Friday, the 22nd of February, in case you're wondering if we're live or not. We are. If you're listening and it's Friday, February 22nd, we actually are in studio, so you can give us a call. 208-377-3790. Can't handle the idea of talking live on the radio with us, then go ahead and send a text message to Calvary Chapel Eagle's phone, 208-891-2635. If you're out there in Facebook Live land, you can leave a comment and we respond to those appropriately. You ready to get going? Yesterday we covered number one and two.
Yeah.
And I think you're just going to really quickly wrap them up and we'll head on to, I'd like to at least get two each day in here as we're doing the series.
I think we could pull that off. My goodness, we have an hour show. So here's the thing, and I think I should read them again, and I will explain a little bit about it. This is from the Fire Study Bible, which I think it used to be the Full Life Study Bible, and they've updated it. And the first one is, we have assurance of eternal life if we believe in the name of the Son of God. There's no eternal life or assurance of salvation without a sincere, life-surrendering faith in Jesus Christ that confesses Him as God's Son, sent to be our Savior and Lord, forgiver of our sins, and leader of our lives. Now, we looked at a bunch of scriptures to support that, so that wouldn't just be a standalone statement. But, of course, the foundational way that you know is faith in Christ. You're trusting in Him. We're going to see some variations on this as we move along here. The second one is this. We have assurance of eternal life if we submit to Jesus as Lord, the supreme authority and leader of our lives, and are sincerely trying to live by His principles and obey His commands. And then he quotes 1 John 2. He says, we know that we have come to know Him if we obey His commands. That's quoting John, okay? The man who says, I know Him, but does not do what He commands is a liar. We looked at that yesterday. And the truth is not in him. But anyone who obeys His word, God's love is truly made complete in him. This is how we know that we're in Him. Again, I want to clarify, you don't get saved by jumping through a bunch of hoops you got to obey this and you got to obey that. But there's evidence that you're saved because, well, what John is saying, all through 1 John, read 1 John over and over again. He says it in various different ways, that if you walk in the light as He is in the light, you have fellowship with one another. If you say you have fellowship with Him and walk in darkness, then you're a liar and the truth's not in you. If you say you have fellowship with God and then you're living in sin, then you're a liar. And so this is kind of tough stuff, okay? But
And this that living Bible. In sin is not, oops, I sinned accidentally. Right. It's living a lifestyle of sin and not caring that it is contrary to what the Bible tells us to do.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
I just didn't want somebody to get overly condemned. Oh no, I sinned. I yelled at my kids this morning. You know, I didn't want somebody to freak out on that one.
Right. And that's why yesterday I also started with my own perspective from 1 John chapter 3, verse 19 through 24, that says, you know, that you look at these things and you could assure your heart that you're right with God. But there's times when your heart condemns you. Matter of fact, read about it. I looked over it all yesterday's show, but it's 1 John 3, verse 19 through 24. And it says, you know, if your heart condemns you, God's greater than your heart. It's possible to be a real Christian who just has a very sensitive conscience, that when you do something wrong, you feel condemned. You feel like there's no hope. And because of it, you feel like, oh, man, I can't be a Christian. I'm not going to heaven. And so there's times real Christians have their hearts condemn them. In 1 John chapter 3, 19 through 24, John addresses that and says there are things you could look at and you could assure your heart, but then sometimes your heart will still condemn you, but just know God is greater than your heart and he knows all things. Anyway, read about 1 John chapter 3, verse 19 through 24. We covered that yesterday, and then we got into the two points that I just read. And now we're going to look at a couple more points. You know what? The last point we're looking at, that we can have assurance of eternal life if we submit to Jesus as Lord, the supreme authority and leader of our lives, and we were reading some verses that I don't think I got to finish. So let me take another look at John chapter 14. This is Jesus' words. John chapter 14, and I know I covered this to some degree yesterday, but it's worth repeating to back up. Repeat it, finish it well, because listen to this. This is Jesus speaking in John chapter 14, verse 21, and he says that he who has my commandments and keeps them, he is the one who loves me. And the one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him. That's a real special promise, but I think it's also an exclusivity to it, where he says, you want to know who loves me? People who go to church, they love me. No, not everybody who goes to church loves the Lord. You know that. Some people aren't on a religious trip. Some people are trying to earn God's favor, and then they're living wrong the rest of their life, but they're trying to earn God's favor. There's all kinds of reasons people go to church, you know. I've seen people go to church because there's good-looking girls at that church, you know. There's all kinds of bad reasons to go to church. But Jesus didn't say, here's how you could tell if somebody loves me. They go to church every Sunday. Or even, I think we talked about it yesterday, sometimes you see somebody who's very emotional, and they cry and they weep during prayer. I've seen people like that who I think they're just a little bit neurotic. I'm not saying if you cry during prayer, you're neurotic, but there are some who, that's the real issue. They're not in love with Jesus. There's something wrong. They're about to crack. And they start to pray, and they start to shake and quiver and cry. Now, it's possible that there's two sides of this, folks. I've quivered and cried in prayer, okay? There's times that's very appropriate. I'm just saying that's not the way you could tell who loves Jesus. According to Jesus, he didn't say he who yells the loudest at church, he who sings the loudest, he who jumps up and down, waves the flags. He didn't say any of that. He says, he who has my commandments and keeps them. Now, remember, this is all proof text for the number two way of having assurance to salvation, that says if we have assurance of eternal life if we submit to Jesus as Lord and supreme authority and leader of our lives. And then there's more to it, okay? But we're looking at verses that some might call legalism. Some might look at what I'm saying here, and you'd say, well, that is legalistic. And I would answer to you, that is Jesus. I am quoting Jesus. And you could say, well, that was the old covenant and the New Testament change. No, Jesus is the new covenant maker. He is the initiator of the New Testament. Now, let me keep reading, and I think I messed up on this one yesterday. Judas, not Iscariot, okay, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Because, oh, That's another real important part. Because in this promise, Jesus says, if you have my commandments and keep them, that's how I know that you love me. And you'll be loved by me. You'll be loved by my Father. And I will manifest myself to you. That means the best way to experience the presence of God, the manifestation of God in your life, is to live a life of obedience, okay? Now, we're talking along the topic of assurance of salvation. How do I know I'm saved? How can I be assured that I'm saved? Again, I'll tell you, it's possible to be saved and not have assurance, but sometimes that's because of sin in your life or you're backslidden. Sometimes it's because your heart's condemning you and you're believing the lies that the devil's telling you. There's all kinds of reasons you could lack assurance. But I like this article because it's saying here, look, if you want to have assurance, stay right with God, walk right with God, live your life in obedience to the Lord. Jesus goes on to say, which by the way, I already commented on the manifestation. A lot of people, have you heard people? Maybe you've said this. I wish I could experience God. How come I don't experience God? Well, be careful with that. Because in reality, if we were sensitive and aware of the sin in our life, we might go, ah, it's because I'm backslidden, or oh, because I'm allowing this pollution in my life, or I've got a habit that's I'm displeasing to the Lord. Of course I'm not experiencing his delight and his presence in my life, because I'm not delighting myself in him. I'm delighting myself in sin, okay? So that could often be a reason. Anyway, so this is leading to the topic of experiencing God's presence, because that what's the greatest assurance you could get? A sense of God's presence in your life, right? I mean, I can't think of a better assurance of salvation than seeing it in God's word, clear promise that you're saved, and then having the very manifestation of Jesus and the Father in your life. And Jesus promises that according to John 14:21, he promises this experiencing the Father and the Son to all who will obey him. Isn't that something? So keep in mind, American Christianity has gone way to great lengths to try to prove you don't have to work your way to heaven. All you have to do is just believe. And if you were one of the predestined ones, or if you're one of the elect, you're saved, and it doesn't matter what you do, God does it all. And they tie you in a theological knot so that you could lose sensitivity to some of these things that Jesus taught. Of course, if I don't live in obedience to God, I'm not going to experience fellowship with God. Of course, I can't have assurance of salvation if I'm living like the devil, okay? So keep reading here. So Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered in John 14:23, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Can you think of any greater assurance of salvation than to experience the fellowship of the Father and the Son? Now, many of you who are listening to the sound of my voice, you know what I'm talking about. You know exactly what I'm talking about, because you're walking with the Lord, you're experiencing his presence, and you have fellowship with the Father. There's others who maybe they listen to Christian radio, but you're not even saved. You got to get saved. That's your solution to that. But then there's that middle ground. There's those people who are Christians who are playing around with sin and playing around with things that will water their life down and make them miss out on the deep fellowship and true fellowship. Jesus came that you might have abundant life, that you might have fellowship with him, not just say a prayer, live how you want, and go to heaven. That's not God's plan of salvation, okay? So Jesus promises here in John 14:23 that if you love him, and we've already seen if you love him, you keep his commandments. That's how you know you love him. It says if you love him, you'll keep his word. And then the Father and the Son will love you and will make their home with you. Well, that's a memory verse, don't you think? That's a verse we should camp on for a while. But I'm going to keep reading because we got a lot of ground to cover. But man, write that down. John 14:21-24. Good stuff, and study it. But I didn't read 24 yet. Let me read 24. He who does not love me does not keep my words, and the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. So Jesus pretty much says, look, what I'm teaching you and all the things I'm saying to you are directly from the Father. The God the Father is speaking to you through God the Son. And if you embrace my words and obey my words, then you're gonna enter in. You're gonna experience fellowship with me and the Father. But if you don't love me, you won't keep my word. So here's something to consider. How do you know if you are saved? Well, one of the things you have to ask, do I love God? Oh, yes, I do with all my heart. Well, wait. How do you know if you love God? Jesus said it here in John chapter 14. Read it. Verse 21 through 26, 24. He's saying that if you keep his commandments, you know, it's like if Linda asked me, do you love me? And I say, yeah. But I live somewhere else, and I'm living with somebody else, and I'm chasing other women around. And is that, I'm not, by the way, but if I was, how can I dare say I love her? And yet I'm living with other women and I never come home. Okay. Love has fruit. Love has evidence to it. Okay. So anyway, John 14.
Love has commitment to it.
Yeah. Well, we knew a song like that. I don't remember that. Okay, so we're going through these verses, looking at 9 ways to have assurance of salvation. And we just covered another one. It's John 14. Let's see. There's another one here. Let me take a look at this. It's John 15, verse 9. As the Father loved me, so also I love you. Excuse me. I'm reading my cross-references and then popping back here. As the Father loved me, I also have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Now, here's something you need to think about. A lot of people don't realize, or they just have their own theology, and they don't want to just look at the clear teaching of Jesus Christ. You can abide in his love, or you could not abide in his love. Jesus commands you and I as Christians to abide. What does abide mean? I think the NIV translates it remain, okay? You remain in his love. That means he puts you there, stay there. He's put you in his love. He's put you in a place, in a position of fellowship with God. Now remain there, abide there, dwell there, stay there, live there. I'm trying to think of different words for abide, but that's pretty much what it means. That means you could choose not to stay there. You could choose not to remain there. As the Father loved me, I also have loved you. Abide in my love. Come on, be honest. As a Christian, have you ever kind of drifted from loving God and loving your neighbor and kind of start living in sin, whether it's backslidden, following the sins of your flesh, or maybe you're angry at somebody and you hate your brother and you want them dead? I mean, have you ever had those extreme times? In those times, you're not abiding in his love, okay? And so it has to be a conscious effort that we choose, you know what? I'm not going to go there. I'm going to forgive. I'm going to love. I'm going to remain in God's love. I'm going to love Jesus and love Jesus' people. And it really, following Jesus really does take, and I'm not painting works into this. I'm saying what Jesus said, abide in my love. Well, look at verse 10. He says, I'm in John 15. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Now, before you go running off with this one, there's a lot of church denominations who have all kinds of commandments that Jesus never made, okay? If you're going to be a Christian right with God in this church, you've got to wear a dress to church, or you've got to wear long pants and never shorts. You've got to wear a suit and tie. You can't do this and you can't do that. Look, there are rules that your church might make up that has nothing to do with the commandments that Jesus is referring to here when he says, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. As a matter of fact, as I've searched the New Testament, and I challenge you to do the same thing, the commandments of Jesus, because he says, keep my commandments, come down to 2 things, love and faith. Love, you love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. There's 2 parts to the love one. And faith is believing in Jesus Christ. Over and over, I'm not going to look it up right now, but I know there's verses that say, this is his commandment, that you love one another and believe in him who he has sent. You know, that's the way Jesus speaks. It's not that complicated. So when Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments, he's talking about keep believing in him, trusting him as Savior, and loving one another. And every commandment that he ever gave is based on love. Okay, so that's pretty important to keep that in mind, because some people will take this and run to the commandments of their church, which are numerous. I mean, some churches have all the length of your arm, a whole list of things of things you've got to do if you want to stay right according to this church, and that's not right. Okay, some people, even some New Testament Christians, will take you to the Old Testament and say if you want to be right with God, you got to keep all the law of Moses. Well, just read a little bit of it and you'll see that's totally impossible. You can't go to the temple anymore. You can't make sacrifices anymore. All that is done away with. And why? It was God's intention that it's done away with, because the new covenant has come. The old covenant has passed away. The new covenant is that the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world has already laid down his life. He's already been the sacrifice for our sins. And all we need now is to trust in that one final sacrifice, not all the laws and sacrifices of the Old Testament. Okay, I'm going to read a few more verses here in John chapter 15. He says, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I've kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I've spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment. You hear it? This is my commandment, that you love one another as I've loved you. You want to know what Jesus' commandments are? It's always about love and faith. Loving God, loving your brothers, and having faith in Christ. And when you have faith in him, that shows in other ways as well. Okay, so I love this. This is my commandment. Now, by the way, in verse 11, I don't want to skip over this. I know Linda says we want to cover at least 2 points, and I haven't got off yesterday's point two. But listen, it says, these things I've spoken to you that my joy may remain in you and that your joy may be full. Listen to me. Do you realize that one of the reasons Jesus taught the things he taught was for joy? It gives Jesus great joy to share the truth of God with us, and he wants your joy to be full as you walk in the fellowship with the Son and with Father and the Son. Okay? He says, these things I've spoken to you that my joy may remain in you. So that's Jesus' joy in us. And then he says, and that your joy may be full. So many people miss this, especially some of the more legalistic churches that are all into keeping the commands and ordinances of the church. Jesus says, you know what? If I give you rules, it's because I want God's best for you. If I give you commandments, it's because I want everything to go smoothly with you. My commandments aren't burdensome, he says. It's to love God and love one another. Is that burdensome? It isn't if you're born again. If you're not born again, it's burdensome because you can't love. You got no love in you, okay? As a matter of fact, the scripture says, we love because he first loved us. And so as Christians, the reason why loving others comes easy is because we know what love is. We've been touched by the love of God. We've experienced the love of God. And because we're so loved and so greatly loved, we can greatly love others, okay? Let's see, am I finished with this? There's a couple more verses here. Verse 13, greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. And you are my friends if you do what I command you. Now, why would he say that? Why would he put a stipulation on it, you know? I mean, some people just go, Jesus is a friend. He's a friend next to you. You know, Jesus is my friend. And me and Jesus, you know, they do the, we're buddies. Me and Jesus are pals. Well, Jesus says, you're my friends if you do whatever I command you. Now, that's an odd friendship, isn't it? But this is the way it is. That's how you could tell who is a friend of God. Those walking in his light, those walking in his love, those keeping his commandments. And that's really important. There's just one more verse here I'm going to look at, and then we're going to move on to the next couple points. It's Hebrews chapter 5, verse 9. It says, having been perfected, he became the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him. And so, is it possible? Here's the question. Is it possible to be a real Christian and be saved and you don't obey Jesus? I think that it's possible that you might have moments, lapses of unbelief, lapses of disobedience. It's called backsliding. But overall, the general picture of a real Christian is that your life is submitted to him. Anything other than that is an anomaly. It's like, yeah, I remember the time I backslid. Yeah, I remember the time I fell into sin there. That can happen to a true Christian. But the overall picture of a Christian's life is one who obeys him. Okay, so if you want to know if you could have assurance, we're talking about ways to have assurance of salvation. I think the author of this article, Nine Ways to Have Assurance of Salvation, is really trying to get across to us, you're going to be greatly lacking assurance if you're living in disobedience, okay? And I hope you get that, and I hope it doesn't, I hope those of you who are walking with the Lord can accept that and embrace it and not have a hissy fit. Like I've seen some go, no, you don't have to do anything. You're born again and that's all there is to it. Well, then don't read the Bible. If you're just born again and there's nothing else you have to do, don't read your Bible. But God gave us his word because he's telling us, now that you're born again, I have a plan for your life and I wrote it all down in my book. Now that you're born again, I have a plan for your life, and there are things I don't want you to do. There's things I want you to stay away from. And then there's things I want you to do. There's things I want you to add to your life. It looks like Linda might have something to say here.
Hi, everybody. I am here today. You know, the thing is, it's not these are things you have to do. Okay? I want to clear that up, because as soon as you say, you have to do this, it then becomes a work. What this should be is a natural fruit in your life. Mm-hmm. If you genuinely love Jesus, you naturally will obey him.
Or supernaturally.
Okay, or supernaturally. Yeah. That's better, by the Holy Spirit. But it's not, you have to do this, you have to obey. It's our desire to obey. It's our privilege to obey the Lord, okay? So, you know, we need to be a little careful with our words here, because right. The have-tos right. Put it into a category of works. And we're not talking works here. We're talking, this is what naturally should come out of your life if you love the Lord, if you really love him. Now, some people may say, yes, I love Jesus, but they never read his word, and they never know what is expected of him. Okay, if you don't know that, then you kind of can't do these things. You can't obey him because you don't even know what to obey, because you didn't care enough to read and find out. If you really want to know what the Lord wants of your life, read your Bible, please. And we've told you before, read Ephesians. It kind of goes down the list. Do this, don't do that, do this, don't do that. Put this on. Put this away. And it's basically helping you in with guidelines of how to not walk in the flesh, but to walk in the Spirit. And that should be a natural thing that comes out of our lives, because we are so grateful for everything Jesus did for us. We can't help but to want to obey him and please him, to make him happy. That makes sense to everybody? I sure hope so.
Right. Okay, I see we just have moments before our station break, but let's see how far I can get with this, because before I begin on the third point, I wrote something down this morning thinking, going over these points, I'm realizing people could think we're being legalistic. People could think I'm putting a works trip on you. And so here's what I wrote. Keep in mind that we're talking about how to have assurance, not how to be saved. If we alter these statements to say we are saved if, then we're teaching legalism. But what this article is identifying is reasons Christians don't have assurance. And we'll pick up here. I hear the music now. Just want to make sure you're getting this right. You want to know if you have assurance? You want to have assurance of salvation? Stay with us. We're going to pick it up after the station break.
You're listening to 94.1 The Voice, KBXL, Caldwell, Boise, radio you can believe in. Stay tuned. Mike and Linda will be right back. Look Up was recently extended to a full hour from 2:30 to 3:30 every Monday through Friday. Mike and Linda want to help you apply God's Word to your everyday life. through Facebook Live, text, and phone. You can ask questions about what the Bible has to say about the real things that are going on in your life. If you would like to text the Sassos, the number is 208-891-2635. The best way to have your question answered is to call the Sassos in the studio right now. That number is 208-377-3790. To learn more about Calvary Chapel Eagle, visit calvarychapeleagle.com. Now here's Mike and Linda.
All right, I was explaining some stipulations about these nine ways to have assurance. Let me continue reading here. I said that what this article is identifying is reasons Christians don't have assurance. And so this article may also be entitled, Why Christians Don't Have Assurance, okay? As well, it's not nine ways to get saved. That's not what we're talking about, okay? So we might appropriately start each one of the following statements we're looking at. We can lack assurance of salvation if we neglect these things in our lives, okay? You know what I'm telling you pretty much is, be who you were born again to be. You know, that's one of the running themes whenever I get a chance to teach on it, is you've got to understand, if you're a child of God, be a child of God. Live like a child of God. Think like a child of God. Talk like a child of God. In other words, be who you are. It's not trying to get saved by being something you're not or by performing some kind of acts of righteousness in order to gain God's approval. It's you're born again. Now be what a born-again person should be. Be what you were born again to be, okay? All right, so these nine principles of how they're not how you get saved, but how to know that you're saved. Let's look at the third one. We took way too much time with the first two. The third one is we have assurance of eternal life if we love the Father and the Son rather than the world, and if we depend upon God's guidance and power to overcome the world's corrupting influences. And then he quotes 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything in the world, the cravings of sinful man, the lust of his eyes, the boasting of what he has and does, comes not from the Father, but from the world. And I think what the author is trying to say here is that if you love the world, you're not loving God. Now, okay, let me clarify something else that the Lord taught me years ago. As a Christian, I've gone through times when I've really become worldly, love the things of the world, but I'm still a Christian. But what he had to show me is when you're loving the world's priorities, the world's value system, and the things of the world, such as the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, when you are loving those things, you're not loving God. You can't love God and sin at the same time, okay? So it doesn't necessarily mean you're not a Christian. It does mean you're not loving God, okay? So that's what it keeps coming back to here, that we have assurance of eternal life if we love the Father and the Son rather than the world, and if we depend upon God's guidance and power to overcome the world's corrupting influences. Again, we're talking about how to have assurance of salvation. I can't give assurance of salvation to you if you come to me and you're totally living according to the priorities and standards of the world. You're dominated by the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. And you're saying, Pastor Mike, I prayed that prayer accepting Jesus as Savior. Am I saved? Well, I can't look into your heart and say, oh, absolutely, you prayed the prayer, then it's a done deal. These are evidences where we can assure our hearts before him, as the scripture says. So this is important. Now, let's see. There's a couple cross-references. We'll take a look at that before we move on. The first one is John 4:4. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them because he who is in you is greater than he who's in the world. Have you ever used that quote? Maybe you've heard it before. Look at the context. They are of the world. Therefore, they speak as the world. And the world hears them. We are of God. He who knows God hears us. He who is not of God does not hear us. This is the Apostle John writing this. So he's saying, if you are of God, you will hear the teachings of the apostles. You will embrace and follow the teachings of the apostles. With that in mind, let me read this again. We are of God, the apostles. He who knows God hears us. He who is not of God does not hear us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. There are people who are, I don't know what they are, but they think they're Christians, they think they're saved, they think they're right with God, but they're not reading the Word, they're not respecting the teachings of Jesus that he taught through the apostles, they're not embracing the New Testament. You can't have assurance, okay? I can't offer you assurance. One more, and then we're moving on to our next point. And it's 1 John chapter 5, verse 4. Whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Okay, so over and over again, it does come back to faith and love. Okay, I think the next verse says, who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? That's the starting point we'll always be brought back to. You can't get anywhere without Jesus. You can't get anywhere without starting at that launch pad saying, I believe Jesus is the Son of God. I believe he died on the cross for my sins and rose again. And from there, you begin to add to your faith and build upon your faith as the scriptures teach. Okay? Again, these nine principles are not how you get saved, but how you know that you're saved as I'm looking through these principles. So here's the next one. Number four, we have assurance of eternal life if... Now, this is going to sound like works again. Listen, if we consistently and persistently do what is right by God's standards, and he quotes 1 John chapter 2, verse 29, if you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone who does what is right has been born of him. Yet he who does what is sinful is of the devil. And so here's the thing. It's pretty plain. Your life has fruit to it. You could tell... You know, what did Jesus say? That a good tree doesn't bear bad fruit and a bad tree doesn't bear good fruit, and you will know them by their fruit. And so you could tell who's a Christian, because someone who's living in sin and living evil life, then they're not a Christian. Those who are, matter of fact, it says, if you know that he is righteous, 1 John 2:29, if you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone who does what is right has been born of him. Now, I know some of you who are a bit theological might have a little bit of problem with that, but you know what? We're just getting back to basics. We're just going back to some of the things that Jesus said. And so what the author of this article is saying is, if you're not consistently, he used two words that are real strong, consistently and persistently doing what is right by God's standards. That sounds like works. That sounds like legalism. But let me tell you something. If you're inconsistent, let's go the other way. If you're living an inconsistent life and you're not persistently following the Lord, you follow the Lord today and tomorrow you're following something else is tugging on your heart and you're all over the place. No wonder you're lacking assurance. No wonder you're wondering, gee, I wonder if I'm really saved. Okay. So again, I've told you true Christians can lack assurance, but there's a reason you lack assurance. When you're walking in the light and walking right with the Lord and being consistent, then you should be experiencing that confidence of faith that you don't have to be walking in confusion. Let's see. There is a, you know what? We could go right to the fifth one. Oh, no, I didn't share the cross-reference. There's one more cross-reference on this, and it's 1 John chapter 3, verse 10.
7 through 10.
Okay, 1 John
chapter 3. You want to start
7. 7 through 10. Little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifest, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him. He cannot sin, because he has been born of God. In this, the children of God and the children of the devil are manifest. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is he who does not love his brother. Okay, now, back to basics, folks. I've quoted a lot from Jesus about this in John chapter 14, but now we're quoting the Apostle John in 1 John chapter 3, and he's saying, you know, good people do good things, bad people do bad things, right? The righteous live righteously. The sinners live sinfully. Okay, that's pretty much what he's saying here. And he says, don't let anybody fool you about this. There are people who take such a high-minded theological view of things that they say, well, I am saved, and therefore I am secure in Christ, and I can have liberty to live how I want, and they do. I mean, they live how they want. And John says, little children, don't let anyone deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. But he who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. And for this purpose, the Son of God was manifest, that he might destroy the works of the devil. So let me just put that in my own words. What John is saying is, the whole purpose Jesus came is to deal with your sin problem, to bring forgiveness of sin and deliverance from sin, and to change the direction of your life, that sin is no longer dominating your life. And so if somebody says, comes to you with their high theology and says, well, I got saved and here's the theological reason for it, I got saved and I'm secure in Christ, and they're living in sin, then you need to take them to 1 John 3:7. Little children, let no one deceive you. Good people do good things, bad people do bad things, okay? And here's another thing. When you do bad things, you experience guilt about it. And especially if you are born again and you begin to live a bit in sin, you play around with sin, and you have a guilty conscience about it, that's a good sign. That's a sign that the Holy Spirit is convicting you and you need to get right with God, okay? That's a good sign when you feel convicted of your sin, when you feel guilty. I remember years ago I read a book by Jay Adams called Competent to Counsel. It was Competent to Counsel. And he says one of the biggest ways to deal with guilt is recognize the source of guilt. And usually you're feeling guilty because you are guilty of something, and repent of that and get right with God, you know? And so too many people, like the psychologist today, will want to help you eliminate guilt. And they'll say, well, you got to realize there's nothing wrong with that, and everybody does that. And they'll explain away guilt rather than identifying, according to the Bible, there's legitimate guilt and then there's false guilt. I would say legitimate guilt is when you're living in sin and the Holy Spirit is convicting you. False guilt, I would say, would be like the condemnation of the devil, where Satan is condemning, not convicting you, not trying to lead you to repentance. But there's times the devil will make you feel guilty about things that you either didn't do or you did years ago and you were forgiven of it. I mean, I have this all the time. You know, I remember, I could tell you stories. I'm going to get on radio with all the stories. But there's always something the enemy will pull up in my mind that'll go, I forgot all about that. And then it'll make me feel guilty for it, okay? So there is a such thing as condemnation, in which case you bring it to the cross, confess it, ask for forgiveness, and move forward. But let's talk about here and now, living here and now. Little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. You want to know if you're right, if someone's righteous or if you're righteous? Are you living righteously? Hello? He who sins is of the devil, and the devil has sinned from the beginning. And for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whoever has been, now here's a verse a lot of people have problems with, trouble with. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed, meaning the Word of God and the Holy Spirit, is in him, and he cannot sin because he's been born of God. Now, there's something a lot of people have a problem with, and I want to, maybe sometimes when you look at it, let's see, I'm going to pull this up in the New American Standard, because I remember the New American Standard really is helpful with this this verse. Oh, here it is. The one who practices sin is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. The Son of God appeared for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. No one who's born of God practices sin, okay? It doesn't mean if you're a Christian, you'll never slip, and you'll never give in to a temptation. The Bible isn't saying here that if you're really a Christian, you'll never commit any sin ever again. It's talking about the practice of your life. It's talking about the overall description of your life. Let me read it again. No one who is born of God practices sin, because his seed, God's seed, the Word of God and the Holy Spirit is in him, and he cannot sin because he's born of God. Let me go a little deeper with this. If you can live in sin and not feel conviction, not feel remorse, not feel guilty, then I could confidently say you're not saved. All right? I would say the big difference is, not that Christians don't ever sin, but when they do, they feel convicted, and the Lord convicts them and brings them back so that they repent of their sin, and because they can't practice sin. And what do you mean by that? Well, whenever I have fallen into sin as a Christian, I what I'm saying to myself, whether I say it in these words or not, I'm feeling it, I can't live like this. I can't live in this sin. I feel miserable. I hate myself and I hate my sin. I don't want to stay in this sin. I don't want to be this. I want to be righteous. I want to be holy. I want to be a child of God. This is what John is painting a picture of here. So we're talking about having assurance of salvation. If you could comfortably live in sin and you don't feel guilty and you make all kinds of excuses, well, he's doing it and everyone's doing it. Everyone's doing this today, and America's passed new laws, and so you could live like this now, right? If you could do that and you feel no remorse, then I would say you're probably not a Christian and you probably shouldn't have any assurance of salvation. But what John is saying in 1 John 3:9 is that if you're born of God, you just can't live in sin. You can for a time. You're miserable. But you can't stay there. You just go, man, you know what? You got one of two choices. You either go, oh, this is horrible. This is miserable. I hate feeling like this. I got to repent and get right with God. Or you go deeper down the hole, deeper and deeper, because sin hardens you. Sin makes you stupid. And sin leads to more sin. And it's like gravity bringing you down. Okay. So again, let me read that the rest of this from the New American Standard. It says, no one who is born of God practices sin because his seed abides in him, and he cannot sin because he was born of God. And by this, the children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. You want to know how you could tell the difference between someone who's a child of God and someone who's not a child of God, someone who's a child of the devil? He says, by this, you know, the practice of their life. You know what? Anybody can say, oh, yeah, I'm a Christian. Oh, yeah, I believe in God. I mean, go to the award ceremonies of Academy Award or the Music Awards and all the worldly people who they're out there singing filth and doing drugs and trading sex partners. They're doing all the kinds of things you know is wrong. And then they'll get an award for one of their for acting or for music or for composing. And they'll say, I just want to give thanks to God for this. And they act like they're a Christian. But you know what? Everything about their life shows you that they're not. So by this, the children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. Anyone who does not practice righteousness is not of God. Now, there's more, but let me just stop there. You want to have assurance of salvation? If you're living in sin, I can't give you assurance of salvation because I'm not sure you're saved, okay? But if you're living right, you're practicing righteousness. Those are the ones who will have assurance of salvation. But wait, there's more. Because he talks about anyone who does not practice righteousness is not of God. But then he adds another stipulation. Nor the one who does not love his brother. There's something a lot of people overlook. They think that they could not do this and not do that. And I don't do this. You know, it's the old, I don't smoke and I don't chew and I don't hang with girls who do. You know, you could brag about all this stuff, but one of the stipulations that the Bible, particularly the Apostle John, puts on how you could tell if somebody's really a Christian is that you love, okay? You love your brother. Because anybody could say, I love God, but, you know, we've already looked at, you could tell by the way they live. But what about if you say you love your brother? That's even more obvious. You could tell who loves if you love your brother, if you're there for them, if by the way you treat him, by the way you talk to him, by the way you talk about him, okay? So anyway, honey, I'm going on, and I'm thinking I'm trying to get through this here. What else is there? One more, John 3:9, did I already read that one?
You already read that
one. Yeah, okay. All right, again, I'll remind you that these nine principles are not how you get saved, but they're how you know you get saved, how you can have assurance that you are saved. As a matter of fact, one of my favorite verses is Ephesians 2:8-9. Everybody loves to quote that. For by grace are you saved, through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. But a lot of people stop there, but the next verse is just as important. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 and 10 says, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works that God has before ordained that we should walk in them." So here's the thing. You're not saved by anything you did. You're saved by what Christ did on the cross for you. And you're saved by grace, what he did for you, that gift of salvation. And through faith, you trusting him and trusting him to be your Savior. But what was the purpose of it all? So that now you could live a different life than you were before. So that now you could live a life free from sin. And now, as a matter of fact, other parts of the scripture says that now you're a slave to righteousness. That's a picture of a Christian, my friend. That's a biblical picture of a Christian, that you're no longer slaves of sin, but you're slaves of righteousness. We're talking about assurance. You can't have assurance if you're a slave to sin. You can have assurance if you're a slave to righteousness. Okay? Now, let's look at the fifth point, and I don't even know how far we'll get into this one because I'm watching the clock. We got maybe 5-6 minutes left here, okay? But once more, I'm doing all the talking. I'm going through these points. They're not my points, honey. So if you got something, she's got that silly grin on her face again. She's going, oh, and that grin says, "You're preaching. I'm going to let you preach." All right. Number five, we have assurance of eternal life if we show true love for others. We just read that in the last verse. Okay. And then he quotes 1 John 3:14. "We know that we have passed from death to life because we love the brothers. This is how we know that we belong to the truth and how we set our hearts at rest in his presence." Okay, there is a long list of scriptures here, and we're just going to begin them today, and we'll probably have to pick it up next week. We'll see how far we get. But 1 John chapter 3, verse 14 says, "We know that we've passed from death to life." And this is the verse that he just quoted, but I just want to talk about it a little bit. "We know that we've passed from death to life because we love the brethren. He who does not love the brothers, his brother, abides in death." Okay, we're talking, how can I have assurance of salvation? How do I know that I'm going to heaven when I die? Well, John says, well, one way you could know that you're saved, that you've passed from death to life, is if you love the brethren. And so you got to search your heart. Again, I told you, this is kind of a self-examination thing. You go, well, you know what? When I've seen my brethren hurting, am I compelled to call or to visit or to pray with them, or maybe sometimes to give money to, you know, so we've had times there's been an older woman who's had her, going to have her electricity or gas shut off, and it's wintertime. We're going to pay that electric bill or the gas bill. We're going to do what we can to help. That's love, by the way, folks. Love is action, okay? And so it says, we know we've passed from death to life because we love the brethren. Doesn't mean just go, oh, I feel it. You know, a lot of people think love is just a feeling. It's not. Love is a commitment to do good to others, even if it's at your own hurt. That's the best way I can describe it. That's kind of like agape love, is to be so committed to someone or something that you are committed to their well-being, even if it means harm to you. Jesus on the cross is a good picture of that. He so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And here's the thing. God loved us so much, but it was to his own hurt to save us. The only way he could save us is he had to make a great sacrifice. So sometimes love does that. So I think
you know, one of the things that with loving people, excuse me, it shows itself. We talked about this before with marriage, but it goes over into all areas of life. If you just think happy thoughts about someone, that usually is extremely selfish, and it only makes you feel better. Because, oh, look at me, I'm such a good person. I had a happy thought that I thought maybe I would go help them. I didn't really help them, but I thought of going and helping them. All that does is ease your conscience and make you think, oh, look, I am good because I had a good thought. It's not always just the thoughts. It's putting those thoughts, putting some feet to them, putting it into action of actually loving people. Okay, when your kid falls down and gets hurt, do you think, I probably should go over there and help them up and make sure they're okay? But if you don't ever do it, do you really love them and do you really care about them? My goodness, if one of our kids fall, our little kids, as parents, we run. We overemphasize what's happened. We want to make sure they're okay. We've done something. We just didn't think, gee, maybe it would be nice if I went over there and seen if they were okay. We do it. Why? Because we love them. We care about them. We care about their welfare. That's how the body of Christ should be. We should be caring about each other, that we literally reach out to each other. We just don't think about it. We actually pick up that telephone. We actually drive over. We actually take that meal. We actually ask, is there something I can do to help you? Without the fear of, oh no, if I say that, then I'm going to have to really do something. I know you know what I'm talking about. Because sometimes people don't want to ask, what can I do for you? Because they're afraid someone will actually give them something to do. But that's where we should do it. That's what we should be willing to do, even if it costs us, even if it interferes with our schedule, what we may have had planned. Okay? So love, true love, has action behind it. Mm-hmm. And I hope you get that part, that if you just think these thoughts, well, I should do this or I shouldn't do that, but you never do them, that's extremely selfish. And all you're doing is making yourself feel better. And wow, I didn't know the music was going to come right now, but there it is, folks. So we made it from 2 through the start of 5. We're going to pick up on this next week. It's Friday. Go to church. Hopefully, we will see you at Calvary Chapel Eagle. God bless. Bye.
If you'd like to know more about Calvary Chapel of Eagle, just go to the website at cceagle.org. Be sure and join Pastor Mike every Saturday at 8 p.m. and on Sundays at 8 a.m. for his radio show, It's All About Jesus. If we ran out of time and you didn't get a chance to call in, you can send your questions to lookup at cceagle.org. And may the Lord richly bless you as you continue to look up to Jesus.
Look full in His word.